Hi. I am delighted and humbled. To be back here with you all again. Because because you couldn't get Guru Nishtha's company. You have to settle for mine. And I'll try to do some justice. And also to express how happy I am to see you all again. I really like it here, and I really like all of you. I've generally been speaking on the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Now I'm in the 14th chapter. This is an interesting part of Srimad Bhagavatam. This is called Uddhava Gita. This is Krishna's instructions to his friend Uddhava about devotional service. The 11th canto starts off in an interesting way. Starts with a little preview. A peek into the end of the Yadu dynasty. Just very quickly. And then there's an encounter between King Nimi who is the king of Videha at the time with the nine sages. They're called Navyogendra. They're sons of King Rishabhdev. Who knows how many sons King Rishabhdev had? That's a question mark at the end of that. Can you put a period? Full stops? 100. Not 100? 100. Strong assertion. Yes, 100. So if Varnashram means caste by birth, then of those 100 sons, we would expect them all to be kings? Does anyone know how many were Kshatriyas? How many of the sons, how many of Rishabhdev's sons were Kshatriyas?
All of them?
What was it, nine? It's just a handful. I think it was nine of the sons were Kshatriyas. Nine, most were Brahmins. And then these nine were sages who wandered the earth. So when King Nimi met them, he asked these nine sages nine questions. And each of them answered one of those questions. I don't remember all nine questions. I'm bad with lists. And I don't remember which sage answered which question and what the answers were. But one of them, the sum of the answers was, all material endeavor is ultimately completely futile. They explained that from a number of perspectives. And after his explanation, one of the sages, again, I don't remember which, gave an instruction that we have heard many times, especially from Swami Tripurari. Tasmad gurum prapadyeta jigyasushe uttama shabde parecha nishnatam brahmani upashmashayam. Tasmad gurum. Therefore, he starts with tasmat. Therefore. This means not everyone needs a guru. The only people who need sadguru are those who are desperate for a comprehensive solution to life's problems. And this is the subject of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is not about religion as we generally understand it. We know how Krishna deals with dharma, with religion, in Bhagavad Gita. He argues with Arjuna from so many perspectives, including dharma.
Rozmawia z Arjuną, przedstawia nauki z różnych perspektyw. uses it,
and then he says, forget it all. Flush it. Sarva dharman parityajya mami. Sarva dharman parityajya. Parityajya. Completely give up. All your concepts of dharma. And take exclusive shelter in me. And he says, even if you incur some sin in neglecting your dharma, I've got you covered. Moksha Ishami, I will relieve you of the reactions. Masuchaha. Don't worry your pretty little head. So this is the last word of Bhagavad Gita. And Srimad Bhagavatam picks up right there. Dharma prochita kaitavatra paramo nirmatsaranam satam. It tells us the subject of Srimad Bhagavatam and who is the appropriate audience. Dharma praujita, for those who have already completely given up all conventional religion. Very strong language. Kaitava dharma, cheating religion. And Krishna Das Kaviraj describes cheating religion in no uncertain terms in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Krishna Das Kaviraj describes cheating religion in no uncertain terms in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Dharma artha kama moksha vancha. Wait, that's everything. Dharma artha kama moksha, that's human life. That's cheating? Yes, because that's all about me. So Srimad Bhagavatam is for those who have given this up. And who are nirmatsaranam satam. They're completely pure at heart. Because they're free from envy. And how are they free from envy? Srila Prabhupada explains this in a sentence in his purport to the second verse of the Bhagavatam that changed my life. Srila Prabhupada explains this in a sentence in his purport. To the second verse of the Bhagavatam. Which changed my life. Srila Prabhupada writes, the transcendental devotees of the Lord not only don't compete with each other, but they strive to create a competitionless society with God at the center. When I read this in 1969 or 70, I was 22. I was actually young. And I knew at that moment I had found the revolution we were all looking for then. And this is a revolutionary idea. A competitionless society focused entirely on pleasing Krishna. So, Tasmad Gurum Prapadyeta Jikyasam Shaya Uttama. So then later, having seen all these things coming to pass, Uddhava, who is a very wise man, after all, he is Krishna's advisor. Approached Krishna and said to Krishna, my dear Lord, I have a bad feeling. So many bad things are happening. Now, including the passing of the Yadu dynasty. It seems to me your pastimes in this world are about to end. Please don't leave me behind. Krishna responds by saying, funny you should mention that. I have another idea. I want you to stay behind just to teach others about the science of bhakti. So come close, I'm going to give you some instruction. So at this point, over 7 chapters, Krishna has given Uddhava so many instructions about the nature of detachment. And the chapters, in a sense, each chapter, in a sense, is very They're very heavy.
Każde z tego rozdziałów jest w pewnym sensie bardzo ciężki.
Each chapter points out the utter futility of all material endeavor.
Każdy z nich pokazuje całkowitą bezużyteczność wszelkiego rodzaju wysiłku w tym materialnym świecie.
And the devotees will always ask me, it's all just bad? And by the end of it, by the end of each chapter, Krishna comes to the real point, which is bhakti. So now in the 14th chapter, Uddhava has more questions. And Krishna has more answers. So I'm going to try to move rather athletically through the first few verses. Because I'd like to focus on two verses. Although I may not get to them until the next talk. I sometimes begin my talks by half joking. I'll try to be uncharacteristically brief. I don't even make that joke anymore. It's no longer funny. So the chapter begins, Sri Uddhava Uvacha. Vadanti Krishna Shreyamsi Bahuni Brahmavadina Tesham Vikalpa Pradhyanam Utaho Eka Mukhyata. Sri Uddhava said, my dear Krishna, learned sages who explain the Vedic literature recommend a variety of processes for achieving the ultimate goal of life. Considering the variety of viewpoints, kindly explain to me whether all of them are equally important. Or if only one of them is supreme. My dear Lord, you have clearly explained the process of unalloyed devotional service. By which one can free himself from all material association. Thus enabling him to fix his mind on you without deviation. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati comments on this verse. That life is meant for attaining the association of the Supreme Lord in his transcendental abode. Life is meant for attaining the association of the Supreme Lord in His transcendental abode. The Supreme Lord responds. In the course of time, Vedic knowledge appeared to be lost at the time of annihilation. Then, when the universe was recreated, I again imparted Vedic knowledge to Brahma. Because I am the religious principles personified. Lord Brahma instructed this Vedic knowledge to his eldest son Manu. Who in turn instructed it to the seven great sages headed by Bhrigu. From the forefathers headed by Bhrigu Muni and other sons of Brahma, appeared so many children and descendants. Who assumed different forms as demigods, demons, human beings, Guhyakas, Siddhas, Gandharvas, Vidyadharas, Charanas, Kindevas, Kinnaras, Nagas, Kimpurushas, and so on. All of them guys. All of the many universal species along with their respective leaders appeared with different natures and desires, generated from the three modes of material nature. Therefore, because of the different natures and desires, of the living entities within the universe, different statements regarding religious principles have come into existence. Thus, due to the great variety of desires among human beings, various philosophies have come into existence. These philosophies have been handed down through tradition, custom, and disciplic succession. There are other teachers who present atheistic philosophies. Now, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur makes an interesting comment on this verse. He says that just as all these different philosophies take their nourishment from they're all like plants growing along the side of the river. So they all take their nourishment from the same water. Which is the Vedas. So he says, neem trees, tamarind trees, and poisonous trees are situated on the banks of the river Ganges. Although they drink the pure and sweet water of the Ganges through their roots, they produce bitter, sour, or poisonous fruit. Similarly, those who are atheistic or demoniac use Vedic knowledge to produce bitter or poisonous fruit, in the form of atheistic or materialistic philosophies. So, Karmakanda looks Vedic. They worship Vedic gods. They say Vedic mantras. They dress up in Vedic clothes. So how is that different from what the bhaktas do? Same thing with the Mayavadins. They chant Vedic mantras. And they recite the Vedic scriptures. And make Vedic arguments. To prove there is no God. But these are fruits that don't make anybody happy. They're nasty fruits. The Lord continues, O best among men, the intelligence of human beings is bewildered by my illusory energy. And thus, according to their inclinations, they propagate various means for attaining what they feel to be the ultimate good. Some say that happiness is attained as the result of performing pious activities.
Pobożne czynności.
Others say that fame, sense gratification, speaking the truth, control of the senses. Okay. Two at a time? Others say that fame, sense gratification, speaking the truth, control of the senses, peacefulness, fulfilling one's self-interest, political influence, wealth, detachment, performance of sacrifice and austerities, giving in charity, the observance of vows, or the performance of one's occupational duties. Are the causes of happiness. So many religions. These people obtain the temporary results of their work. Indeed, the meager and miserable situations they achieve simply award them unhappiness because they are based on ignorance. Even while enjoying the fruits of their labor, such persons are constantly filled with lamentation. This verse reminds me of a verse that Prabhupada often discussed. From the second chapter of the Bhagavatam. Dharmasya hyapavargasya narto artaya yopakalpate, excuse me. Sutta Goswami says, Dharma is meant for ultimate liberation. Not for sense gratification. Dharma is not about you. It's about Krishna. Dharma prochita kaita vutra paramo nirmatsaranam satam. Prabhupada talked about this word, apavargasya. The path of liberation is sometimes called apavarga. This is a play on words. In Sanskrit, among the consonants, there are different vargas. And they are named according to, they're named according to the first letter in that group. One Sanskrit word for group is varga. It's like we talk about our guru varga. So we have the pavarga, they start in the back. Ka, Very Sanskrit is a very scientific language. The consonants are organized according to the place and manner of articulation. So the first varga is the ka varga. The gutturals in the back. Ka ka ga ga na. And anyway, and then the last one is the pa varga. Pa pa ba bha ma. You have. So the first one is pa. And that stands for. Actually, this pa varga is used as a metaphor. For material existence. So, the first one, pa, stands for parishram. Parishrama means hard work. The second is pa, which stands for pena. Foaming at the mouth. The next one is ba, which means vyartata, which is frustration. Because after working hard, we become exasperated. We're always looking forward to Friday. In America, we say thank God. They say thank God it's Friday. The next one is bha, which stands for bhaya, which means fear. We're always afraid things won't go right. We're always afraid we'll lose what we've gotten. And the last one, ma, stands for mṛtyu, death. It's all finished. This is our situation in the material world. If we understand this, then we need a guru. Krishna continues, O saintly Uddhava, my all blissful form, manifests in the heart of one who has freed himself from all desires for sense gratification. And who is fully surrendered to me. The happiness he enjoys in my association cannot be compared to the happiness one experiences by gratifying the senses.
Nie można porównać do szczęścia, jakiego doświadczyć można
Can you imagine? The happiness hanging out with Krishna? Compared even to our best day? One who does not desire anything of this world and who is peaceful, self-controlled, always equal to everyone, and self-satisfied, finds only happiness wherever he goes. Sounds cool, huh? Sounds good to me. For those who have attained the merciful sidelong, a pure devotee whose life is dedicated to me, has no desire even for the position of Brahma or Indra, or to speak of becoming a lord of this world or of the lower planets. He is not interested in achieving the perfections of mystic yoga. Or even liberation from the cycle of birth and death. Because his life is simply dedicated to me. Note this well. Nota bene. My dear Uddhava, neither Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, Lord Sankarshan, the Goddess of Fortune, nor even my dear self, is as dear to me as you are. Imagine. Lord Brahma, the Lord's Son, Lord Shiva, the Lord's friend, Lord Sankarshan, the Lord's brother, Lakshmi, the Lord's wife, even his own self, not as dear to the Lord as his devotee. Wow. And then he says, thinking that I will purify the entire universe with the dust from their lotus feet, I always follow in the footsteps of my devotees. Who are free from material desires, wrapped in thought of my pastimes, peaceful, non-envious, and equal to all living entities.
I
those with no material possessions, who are peaceful, free from pride, affectionate to all living entities, who have no desire for personal gratification, and who serve me with undivided attention. Enjoy in me a happiness that cannot be known by those lacking such detachment from the material world. That's a high bar to me. But it's a nice goal to strive for. Maybe it seems impossible to us where we are. But it's something to aim for, at least. In the next two verses, which I'll have to address next time, Krishna talks a little bit about bhakti. In a way that makes it seem a little more generous and accessible. Does anyone have anything to add or any questions?
In this verse spoken by Navayogendras, this verse mentions some qualities of Sadhguru. And the last quality is that he is peaceful. So, could you perhaps say something? Because it seems that this is not only some, you know, that he is peacefully sitting and something like that, but it seems that it has some deeper meaning. Can you say something more about peacefulness?
Krishna says something about peacefulness in Bhagavad Gita. I mean, first of all, he says we can't be happy unless we're peaceful. But he also tells us the way to become peaceful. He tells us what it means to be peaceful. At the end of the fifth chapter. You know this one? Bhoktaram yogyatapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhridam sarvabhutanam gyatvamam shantivachati. If we have this understanding, bhoktaram yogyatapasam, sorry. Bhoktaram yogyatapasam. That Krishna is the real beneficiary, the real enjoyer. Of everything. Including our austerities, sacrifices, and penances. And that he is Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. He's the Supreme Lord of everything. Well, he's the real, he's the supreme enjoyer, he's the supreme master of everything. Where does that lead me? He says, Suhridam Sarvabhutanam. I'm the dearmost friend of every living entity. Bill Gates is a very rich man. I'm not. But if I were Bill Gates' buddy, then I wouldn't have a problem. If I wanted something, I could just say, Bill. I could use a new MacBook Pro. Oh, wrong guy. I could use a new Windows machine. It wouldn't be a big problem. And Krishna says, Suhridam Sarvabhutanam. Not just any friend, Suhrit. Srila Prabhupada, in discussing this verse, sometimes explained that there are different kinds of friends. One is Bandhu, like an acquaintance. Then there's Mitra, like a buddy. Somebody you like to hang out with, get into trouble with. And then there's Suhrit. His heart is all about your heart. He's always your well-wisher. That's the kind of friend Krishna is. He is always thinking of our benefit. So Krishna is not just an acquaintance. He's always thinking of our benefit. Suhrit, very good heart. So, the kind of peace that we see in these verses, the kind of peace that's described in that verse from early in the third chapter of the 11th canto from the Navayogendras. That piece is based on this close relationship with Krishna. That's described in these verses. Everything is about Krishna. So these are all kind of an expansion of the Bhagavad Gita verse. Cowherd boys were completely peaceful. Big demon would show up in the forest. And the cowherd boys were cool. Another adventure. We got more stories to tell when we get back home tonight. Cowherd boys were not at all intimidated by Aghasura. Oh wow, look at that cave. Looks like a big snake. Oh, P.U. Bad breath. Oh, wait a minute, maybe it is a snake. Whatever. Let's check it out. If it is a snake, Krishna will take care of us. Just like one of Bhaktivinoda Thakur's Sharanagati songs. It starts Atma Samarpane Gelau Himan. It's like a Sakya Rasa song. It's like the cowherd boys are just marching into Aghasura's mouth. It's all good. We don't care. Krishna's our buddy. So it's that kind of peace from understanding that Krishna is everything. There's nothing but Krishna and his energies. And I'm one of those energies. And I have a close connection with him. So it's based in that knowledge. And it's knowledge based on experience. Not just theoretical knowledge. So he doesn't have to go back and check the calculations. That help?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Well, he said, oh, sorry. Mentions Sankarshan, kind of a Tattva Balaram, rather than a Rasa Balaram. Let me find the verse again. He says, Natata na me priyatama, Atma yonir na shankara, nacha sankarshano na shrir. So, he says, not Atma yoni, not Brahma, my own son. Not Shankara, Lord Shiva, my friend. We know he's a devotee. Vaishnavanam yata shambhu, Bhagavatam says. Not Sri, goddess of fortune. Not just a devotee, but Krishna's Narayan Swarup Shakti. And even his own self. He's making a point about the prominence of the Vaishnavas. That even he worships the Vaishnavas. Let me see that with, well, he worships Sudama Brahmana to show he worshiped the Brahmins. But Krishna is making a point that the Vaishnavas, because of all these qualities, that he lists in the surrounding verses, that they're more dear to him even than those who are closest to him. Such as his friend Shiva, his brother Balaram, No, but he's making a point about the devotees. Just like what Swami was discussing last night about the distinction in Brihad Bhagavatamrita, the distinction between Nityasiddha and Sadhana Siddha. The Nityasiddhas, they're siddha. They're perfect in love for Krishna. But what's missing is that love hasn't been tested. So Balaram, he's the root of the serving attitude, right? Lakshmi is made of love for Narayan. But the devotees, especially the sadhakas, they develop these qualities through their practice. Just as steel becomes tempered. Through much trial. You know how they make the samurai swords? The stories about the samurai swords? I know. The best steel. Make it white hot. Beat it. put it back in the fire, eat it some more, plunge it in ice water. So much trial. And only such a blade is worthy of the samurai. So Krishna so much appreciates, just as he expressed to Sarupa. He told Sarupa at the end of Brihad Bhagavatamrita, I know all you've been through. And I appreciate it. And I'm so happy to see you. How happy was Krishna to see Sarupa? When he saw him, he passed out. Krishna passed out. And all the residents of Goloka thought, oh no, is Krishna dead? We heard about these demons. We hear these stories. We didn't think they really existed. Is this kid one of those demons? Did he kill Krishna? But Krishna was just in ecstasy seeing his devotee. So Krishna is maybe being a little hyperbolic to make a point. This is poetry, after all. And hyperbole is an alankar. It's a very wonderful figure of speech. Is that okay? Anything else? Okay, thank you so much for your company and your attention.